Well, hello everyone. If you're joining us, this is Let Us Reason. I'm your host, Al Fadi, and with me here, a very special guest that you've been introduced to a couple of times already, our dear brother, Alex Blagojevich. And as you know, Alex was here at least twice, if not more, and every Wednesday, Lord willing, the exact same time, you've been warned. Every Wednesday is the exact same time he will be with me, and we're going to continue to take a journey through his book, I think he called it Why We Trust the Bible, or Why I Trust the
Why
Bible?
Why I Believe in the Bible.
I Believe in the Bible. So that's why we have the title of our show, at least to coincide with this. And our dear brother, of course, has been walking us through argument by argument in his book that will be published soon, and I'll let him share more details with you. So, brother, welcome back, and thank you for making time for us.
Thank you for having me, Brother Al. It's nice to be here.
You want to tell people a little bit about this book that you're working on?
Sure.
Or you've completed technically and you're just...
It's pretty completed. I'm having it edited right now. And then I was going to ask a friend of mine, I was going to meet him this month, actually, this next week. But because of coronavirus, we're not going to meet. We were going to meet in Europe, and I'm not going to divulge his name, but I want to ask him if he would write the introduction of a book. But since we're not going to be meeting, that's been delayed a little bit. So we'll see. If he doesn't write the introduction, that's fine. We'll publish it because we need to get it in the hands of people. I'm thinking this summer or by the fall, I'll have it published. I don't hear you. Al, I don't hear you. You're on mute.
I'm sorry. It contains a number of arguments in a book. How many of those arguments you have 20, in there?
25. I could add some more. And also I was thinking of having some of my friends, apologists, adding in the, after you know, the book is finished, having a few chapters with other people's a few points, if I could find 3-4 people, Christian apologists or scholars, to add some points. A couple of my friends had some really interesting points to add to my points.
Excellent. So I'm going to go ahead and pull the book just to be in front of me, but please continue from where we left off last time. And I think we finished last time talking about the fact that the Bible has some embarrassing arguments in it.
Yes. So I don't actually remember where we stopped, but yes, the embarrassing, the principle of embarrassment, that's pretty powerful, Brother Al, because again, if something, why would you make something up if it's embarrassing, right, to your cause, or embarrassing? So things such as Mary being virgin pregnant, that's pretty embarrassing if it's not true. Why would you claim to have denied the Lord 3 times and things of that nature? Those are not very points that anybody would be proud of in the Bible. So a lot of those, and in the Old Testament also, you see it a lot in the New Testament, but in the Old Testament also, I mentioned it, where the Israelites were really kind of treated harshly by God, and there was nothing really to be proud of. And David is an adulterer, and all those things. And we talked last time about Muslims when I debate them, saying, David was an adulterer, and Moses was a murderer. So what does why are you criticizing Muhammad when he did those things? Well, because there's nothing, when it's in the Bible, it's nothing to be proud of. It's actually embarrassment. It's embarrassing, and it is a sin. It is revealed as a sin. It's just that God was still using those men. But in the Quran, Muhammad was proud to be, there's a hadith where it says that he had the power of either 100 or 1,000 men, sexual power that God had given him. So he was very proud of being so sexually active. So nothing to be proud of in the Bible. It is a sin. Just because it's revealed and it's written in the Bible, there's nothing to be proud of. So I don't know if that's where we stopped. But we talked.
Yes, that's where we stopped. And obviously, I appreciate you bringing this up. And you know, Alex, what would you say to someone who said exactly what you just mentioned? You know, because our Muslim friends are starting to change their tone about Muhammad, and now some of them are coming to grip that he has an embarrassing life, an embarrassing right. biography. So they will use the same thing and say, "Well, guess what? You know, look, Muhammad was rebuked in the Quran. Why would he do something like that if it was an invention?" Do you have a way to respond to this? I mean, is it just that reason why you believe in the Bible, or is it a
no? It's not obviously. Obviously, you know, it's not any one reason, but I find them all to be very, very strong. And especially when you put them all together, then you have a very strong case for it. And then later on, we'll talk about the critics' response. To those claims, and you will see that he gave me even more faith and trust in the Bible and more faith in Jesus when you read the critics' explanations of those points. But you know, one thing to be considered is that David is not our Lord, okay? Moses is not our Lord. Abraham is not our Lord. They're human beings, right? They are broken human beings. Jesus is our Lord, and he's the one that we put our faith in, and he's the one, you know, the saying, "What would Jesus do?" So he's the one that we look up to, right? He's our role model. When I wake up in the morning and I have a dilemma, I never ask myself, "What would David do?" Okay, I ask myself, "What would Jesus do in this, and what would he want me to do?" The reason it's important to mention that is because to Muslims, their role model is not David or Moses, it's Muhammad. It's Muhammad is the perfect example. For the Quran says, I think in chapter 33:21, it says that he is the role for the model for humanity, right? So again, if he's your model for humanity, then let's compare him not to David or Moses, but to Jesus, right? The role model for humanity to Muslims and the role model for humanity to Christians. And when you compare the two, well, guess what? There's no comparison. One never sinned according to the Bible and according to the Quran. So the Muslims would have to admit that Jesus was sinless, right? But although Jesus never committed any sins, Muhammad, on the other hand, committed every sin possible that I can think of, Muhammad committed it. So who do you want to...
He broke all the law, by the way. It broke all of the commandments, no doubt.
Every single one. I went through all of the commandments, all of the laws, and he broke every single one of them. Now, who should be your role model? I know that I believe that the Quran says it, you know, Muslims will say that all of the prophets were sinless, right? But again, that's not true. It's not true. David sinned, Abraham sinned, Moses sinned. So they sinned. So to say that they were sinless, no. Maybe their perception is that, you know, according to God, they were still as sinless. But no, they were not sinless. They sinned. The thing to remember is that Muhammad did ask for forgiveness in the Quran. Twice he asked for forgiveness for his sins. Of course, they all say, well, but Jesus was baptized, so he was just doing it as an example to humanity. But again, if you understand what, you know, Muhammad's life was, he was a sinner in accordance with by the Bible, and so was everybody else. You, me, and every Muslim and every Christian, we're all sinners, right? And because we're all sinners, and we'll talk later about the need for forgiveness and redemption, we're all guilty in front of a perfect God. The God of the Bible is perfect. He cannot not judge every single sin. And that's why you and I, and every Muslim and every Christian, we have no chance on our own. None. Zero. When we get in front of God, we're guilty. So we either go and ask for justice, in which case we end up in hell, or we ask for mercy and grace, in which case we get Jesus Christ and his sacrifice on the cross. But if you look at Muhammad's life, he was a sinner according to the Bible. So why do Muslims look him as a role model, and they continue to do things that Muhammad did and that are completely contradictory to the nature of Christ and to his teachings and to his life? So again, I'd rather look up to Jesus Christ and use him as a role model than I would Muhammad, who was not a role model. And the only way the Muslims can justify his actions is by saying, well, you have to put it back in context, right? You have to put it back in context. Always put it back in context. Well, that's a problem for Islam also, because if Islam is the Quran, is the last word of God, and it's eternal with Allah, then we should not have to put it in context. I don't put back things back into context, except for a couple of things from Paul, where he speaks to specifically to churches, and you have to put it back in context. Except for that, the words of Jesus, you do not have to put any of them back in context. They were true yesterday, today, and they'll be true tomorrow when I wake up.
Amen. The important thing here that we need to talk about also is that this doctrine of Isma, yes, which the Muslims will tell you all of the prophets are sinless, which is not true, by the way. The Quran does allude to the fact that Moses killed. It mm-hmm. does talk about that. Yeah. But regardless of the fact that, whether the Quran wants to admit it or not, the very doctrine that all prophets are sinless doesn't even exist. The only one that was emphasized to be sinless from his birth is our Lord Jesus Christ. And as you mentioned, in the Quran, in multiple places, Muhammad was clearly mentioned as someone who is a sinner. So thank you for clarifying that. Now, what is the next point that you would like to address, brother?
So again, I'm so sorry, I got a little lost, but we went through the manuscript evidence, I believe.
We can revisit it. I mean, there is no saying why we can't, because this is very important, honestly. Let's go back, because I'm studying manuscripts of the Quran right now, and that's extremely important. You can see the difference between the amount of evidence that we have when it comes to the Bible, New Testament, Old Testament, and translations of it, ancient, older ones, versus what the Quran has, for instance. So please, go ahead.
Well, again, and yes, I remember we covered it so very quickly. I don't want to bore your audience if they've already heard it, but I think it's so powerful when you compare, and it came back to me when I started comparing notes with Plato and Aristotle and Caesar. I remember we had talked about it. But when you compare the manuscript evidence for the Bible to the manuscript evidence for anything else, absolutely anything else, before Jesus, during Jesus, after Jesus, 600 years later, Islam, there's no comparison. No comparison with the proximity, how close we have manuscripts to the actual events, which, of course, the closer to the actual event, the more we know those events were true. If they come out 5 centuries later, then, obviously, serious historians would seriously question the veracity of those events. But again, the proximity, we have manuscripts with us that are as early as 30 years after the writings. I mean, that is absolutely so early. And one of the points we looked at earlier on, I think in our first session, Brother Al, is the proximity, that there's not enough time for legend to creep in, right? If you have those manuscripts. Now, surely, think about it. If it would be one thing if Christians had the upper hand, right? They had the upper hand, like Muslims had the upper hand, right? After Muhammad died, they had the upper hand. They conquered Mecca, and they had the upper hand. It's one thing when you have the upper hand, and you can destroy whatever contradicts what you want to say, right? You've heard it said that that those who win the war or win battles are the ones who write history, because they can do it, right? Who is going to contradict them? But Christians actually were not winning anything. They didn't have the upper hand. They had the lower hand. They were the ones persecuted, and yet no one can come up with a manuscript that truly contradicts anything in the Bible. That's so powerful. Even people who didn't believe in Jesus admit that the body is missing. They admit that he did miracles. They admit all of these things. They just don't believe in the veracity. For example, if a critics at the time claimed that Jesus performed miracles, they would say, yes, he did perform miracles, but he was from the devil. So again, they're just not attributing it to God, right? They're not denying any of it. So the manuscript evidence is so powerful that we know for the Bible to be 99.6% pure, which is so, so powerful. Now, somebody could say, well, it should be 100% pure, right, if it's a word of God. Well, we're still finding things. But that's the beauty of Christianity. The beauty of Christianity is that The 0.4% is meaningless. It's really not relevant. It's not it's not really dealing with anything fundamental, any fundamental doctrine. For example, let me use one example, the adulteress, the story of the adulterous woman. Well, those, we don't have early manuscripts, so it's possible, although I believe that we will find some manuscripts and it's going to make the Bible even more credible. But that story, if someone is honest, could be saying, you know what, maybe it's not part of the original, but that's okay. It's all right. It's one story, you know, over the last 11 verses of Mark. At least we're honest. We're genuine. You know what? It could not be part of the original, but does it change anything about Jesus? Does it change anything about the fundamental doctrine of Christianity? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Changes nothing. So yes, it's only 99.6% pure, but guess what? That's sufficient to say that it's pure enough that we know for certainty that what we have is what happened in history. And that is very important to remember, right? So so again, it's important. And when comparing it, and I did the last time, when comparing to other books, you know, such as Plato, instead of having 24,000 manuscripts of Christianity right. for the Bible, we have 7 for Plato. And the first copy we have 1,200 years after the event. And yet, nobody denies Plato. Aristotle, 49 compared to 24,000 and 1,400 years after Aristotle. Caesar, 10, only 10 manuscripts compared to 24,000 for Christianity, for the Bible, and 1,000 years later, after the first manuscript we have in our possession for Caesar, so people understand, is 1,000 years after Caesar, and yet nobody denies Caesar, right? And the one, the winner, the big winner is Homer's Iliad, which was 600, a whooping 643 manuscripts compared, again, to 24,000 and 500 years after Homer's Iliad. Islam, 6 centuries later, should have more manuscripts than Christianity because they had the upper hand, and they should have more manuscripts, and the proximity should be much closer to the actual events. And yet, we don't have a lot of manuscripts, but what more importantly, we had a Muslims who had the upper hand, who were destroying their own manuscripts because they were so contradictory in nature.
And by the way, we have enough evidence to support this notion that part of it was destroyed. We have evidence of that for sure. And also the other part that is made it through was corrected later. So, brother, I want to add one more thing. I'm going to put a comment here on the screen right now. You're going to see it. This, you know, there, we have a lot of clowns usually. They show up. This is one of those chief clowns right here. And his argument, as a typical argument, of course, that, you know, the Jesus of John is different than the Jesus of the Synoptic Gospels. And, you know, talking about external evidence, and you mentioned manuscript, one can say the Quran is considered to be another historical writing that confirms what the Bible teaches. We're going to say one thing, you know, for instance, to answer our chief clown here. If the Jesus of John is so problematic for our friend here, one would wonder, why would the God of Islam confirm what John said about Jesus? For instance, it says that in the beginning, the Word. Guess what? And the Word became flesh. What an amazing thing. The same Word who is God in John was actually mentioned in the Quran to be Jesus. Right. Who is the Word of God? What an amazing thing, isn't it? So things like this usually can be used, and in this case, used against those clowns, to prove that even their own writing supports what the Bible teaches. But we thank really our clown. I mean, we always enjoy having him here. So keep going, brother.
Well, I could I mention something to
Absolutely.
Abraham? Actually, Abraham, I don't know him. I don't know his heart. I don't know what he is trying to, what if it's genuine about his point or not. But a lot of us scholars are hurting, you know, the claims of Christianity, because a lot of scholars are making some claims that are not true, you know. And it's sad, because you'll hear, and then Muslims hear it, and then they'll repeat things, that the Jesus of John is different than the Synoptic Gospels, the first three Gospels. But actually, no, it's not. First of all, I want to mention, if it were exactly the same, then they would say, oh, look, John is copying from the other three. So it would be, there will always be a reason to deny it. But here's the important part. John is writing to a different audience, and he's writing a little later on. The other gospel writers are writing to usually a Jewish audience and all that. So, and to say that only in John do you see Jesus claiming the I am, right? It's not true. Mark, the first, the earliest of all gospels is Mark, most probably. And in it, Jesus claims the I am. He's claiming the Yahweh. He's claiming deity. So to say that John is the first one, the only one who's making up his deity of John, of Jesus, is not true, Abraham. I don't know your heart. I'm praying that you are genuine in your questioning, and you could very well maybe. But listen carefully. It is not different. You can take John out of all of it, and you still have the same Jesus in Mark, Matthew, and Luke. So again, it's just three different styles of writing. And John, you got to remember, he's the only one who, you got to remember, Jesus had to be careful also during his ministry, because his time was not yet to be crucified, because they were waiting to stone him, right? So a lot of the writers of the Gospels earlier on had to deal with a very, very ferocious audience that was waiting to stone them to death, and they all ended up being stoned and killed and beheaded and thrown out of buildings and all those things, but and crucified. But remember something, Abraham, that those writers are writing to an audience, and it is clear if you look at the book Putting Jesus in His Place, you'll see how clear Jesus' deity is in the first three gospels. So to say that John is making it up or starting a new Jesus with and making up stuff about him and coming up with his deity is just not true. If you study, and I pray that you will study and you will look into it, and I recommend that book, Putting Jesus in His Place. If you're genuine, and I pray you are in Jesus' name, if you're genuine, please search it, read that book, and you'll see that you can take John out of and keep the three gospels, and you get the same Jesus. It's not a different Jesus.
And I want to support what you just said about Mark, brother. Here is another argument that our Muslim friends, I mean, I don't know about you, brother, but lately I'm noticing that our Muslim friends shooting themselves in the foot, literally, it's almost like they're discounting everything their own book is saying. Yeah. For instance, in John chapter two, Jesus healed the paralytic, right? Healed the man who basically was paralyzed, and his friends brought him in a stretcher. They lowered him down through the roof. And it says that he looked at their faith and he says, your sins are forgiven. And then he commanded him to stand and walk. I mean, and people in their heart, the Pharisees, were saying, why is this man committing a blasphemy? Mm-hmm. Only God can forgive sin. So right there, they acknowledged that it's a divine prerogative, a divine attribute that Jesus was committing. But here's the funny part. In chapter 4, in Mark chapter 4, verses 26 to 28, you remember the parable of the seed and the sower.
Yes.
The Quran quoted from it. Once again, if you quote from a book, then you're acknowledging the entire message of that book.
Right.
You can't pick and choose.
Good, very good point, Brother Al. Very good point. And also, forget about John for a second. Let's look at the names and the attributes of Allah in the Quran, right? And see what the Bible, the Synoptic Gospels, say about Jesus. And then see if that lines up. Again, a lot of the names, the resurrection and the life, you have Alpha and Omega, all those names are given to Jesus, right? And those are names for Allah. I was thinking about, I don't know if it's been done before, but I was thinking about my next project, writing a booklet, not a book because I want people to read it, but a booklet about the 99 names of Allah and attributes, whatever the Quran, the attributes for Allah are, and how Jesus had those attributes and how Jesus had those names. Because maybe some Muslims will realize that the Bible is so clear that whatever is attributed to Allah alone and names to Allah alone, Jesus attributed to himself. So I thought that would be a good little project. I don't know if it's been done before.
Maybe you and I could work on doing this through this series, brother, after you're done with your book. So what is the next point?
Very quickly on the manuscript, very, very, very quickly. A manuscript, a lot of people, and forget about just Muslims, just people in general that I talk to, they say, well, Alex, you know, the church decided what books to do, blah, 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 blah. How about the gospel of Philip and Mary and blah, 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 and all that, Thomas? So when you look, again, if you're a serious scholar, and scholar doesn't mean you have to get a PhD. If you're just a seeker, forget about scholar. You don't have to be a scholar to be a Christian. If you're a seeker, just look at the evidence again, manuscript evidence. The reason those books are not in the Bible is because they were not written in the first century. So the Gospel of Mary could not have been written by Mary or Thomas, you know, again, Peter. Again, those are fake. Those are Gnostics written centuries later, 100 years after the first century, after those people would have lived. So again, it's not possible that they could have been written by those writers. So, and interestingly, and I mentioned in one of your webcasts, is that a lot of the stories which are from Gnostics end up in the Quran, right? The infancy of Jesus, when he speaks from the cradle, that ends up in the Quran, or he gives life to birds of clay, that ends up in the Quran. But those are stories that are written much later, 400, 500 years after the first century. So somehow, interestingly, they end up in the Quran, but not in the Bible because they were not written in the first century. But I thought that would be interesting to mention it again. So point number eight is that...
Hey, give me a second, brother, if you don't mind. I want to ask Beth and others, are you hearing me better now? Because some of you are saying that you are not hearing me as loud as Alex. Alex is a loud mouth, you know. I'm not a loud mouth. I'm a nice guy. That's why. So just let me know. All right, brother, keep going.
Okay. So point number eight, and I'm so sorry, I don't remember if we went through it, but we don't have to spend a lot of time. But the disciples, well, you remember when I told you in the two things that really hit me really hard? One was the prophecies when I was seeking. One was the prophecies. This one was already also big, not for the Western audience, but Eastern audience, such as your Muslim friends, our Muslim friends who are watching. This one should be a big one. And that is number eight, that the disciples had nothing to gain. I think it's huge because, again, here in the West, it's no big deal. You know, okay, here's this Jesus person, new movement. Hey, let's follow him. But to Jews in the first century, it was a huge deal. It was a big deal. And Muslims should understand that, especially Arab Muslims from Saudi Arabia, for example. If you leave Islam and follow Jesus, life is not going to be so easy, especially if you're from Afghanistan, Pakistan, Saudi Arabia. So your family may deny you, probably will. If you're still there, they probably will kill you. So it's not easy and not such a no big deal kind of thing. It was a huge deal. And this point that the disciples had nothing to gain, again, they were Jews in the first century. The first thousands of believers were not Gentiles. They were Jews. They were Jews living in a very strict community, living under the law, and trying to be obedient. So they were not, to all of them to leave. They were not leaving Judaism because Christianity is really true Judaism. It's the fulfillment of Judaism. But for them, for their communities, they were living Judaism, and they were going into paganism or whatever they were getting into, idolatry. And so for all of them to leave and for all of them to be persecuted to the death and for none of them, zero of them, to recant or to come back, it's really quite interesting. Because again, they so believed that Jesus was risen from the dead, and most of them had seen it with their eyes, that this Lord of theirs, which they did not understand, which they thought was going to conquer the Roman Empire and deliver them physically, when they saw him die on the cross, they lost all hope and faith. But when they saw him on the third day, risen from the dead, something happened to them. And then on Pentecost, when they received the power of the Holy Spirit, from there on, none of them, they were following Jesus. And they're like, if I have to die, actually, you're doing me a favor because I'll be with Jesus tonight. So again, it is a big deal for the disciples to leave Judaism. But again, I want to explain, they were not leaving Judaism because following Jesus is true Judaism. Jews who meet Jesus and follow him are true Jews because he is the Messiah of Israel and he came to save them. And he's the fulfillment of the prophets and the law and the prophets, as the Bible tells us.
Yes, and Anne is one of our amazing friends here at both channels, basically Facebook and YouTube, and she's saying, you know, the Quran basically, and rightfully so, is silent when it comes to important names. You know, for instance, Mary is the only woman that is mentioned in the Quran by name, Mary, right, the mother of Jesus, when in fact the mother of Muhammad is not even mentioned. The narrative of the birth of Jesus is mentioned. The narrative of the birth of Muhammad is not mentioned. Along the line of what you just mentioned about the apostles and what did they get to gain from this, you know, some of them wrote these gospels. In other words, jeopardize even their own safety and security by putting their name in there when it says the gospel account according to Matthew, according to Luke. I mean, why would they do something like this if they're gaining, they're not selling it on Amazon. They lost their life on account of this, you know, so that's extremely important, of course, for us to point out. Keep going, brother.
Extremely important point. And now that you mentioned the Quran, Muslims, and that when I read the Sirah, again, the Sirah being the biography of Muhammad, I couldn't believe it. You know, the Quran is a little difficult to understand, but the Sirah opened my eyes. And in I remember story after story of people coming and saying, you have to convert. If you don't convert, we will kill you. If you're going to convert to Islam or if you're Jew and Christian, you could live, if you're people of the book, you could live under domination and pay the jizya tax. But the interesting, read the Sirah, the last 600 pages, page after page, people are converting, not really believing, but they're fearful. They're fearful for their lives. And they're like, hey, listen. I even remember one story. I need to find it so I can be very specific. I think it was some kind of a soldier who went back home in the Sirah, and he told his family we're converting to Islam. And I think his wife, and I apologize if the details are not correct, but it's definitely there. His wife said, you know, I don't want to convert to Islam. And he said, we have to because it will be beneficial to us. So again, people were converting to Islam because it was going to get them something. You know, even if they didn't believe in their hearts that Muhammad was the prophet of God, Allah was one, unique, and they were just whatever, worshipping whatever or nothing, they were converting to Islam because they knew it would preserve their lives and it would get them maybe favor. And the same thing happens under any dictatorships. When my parents grew up in Yugoslavia, if you did not accept of a state, the communist state, and worship and deny you of your baptism certificate and all around deny your faith in God and Jesus and didn't follow the state, didn't give your allegiance to the state, you were shunned. My grandmother wouldn't do it. God bless her. God bless her. She, her whole life, she suffered because she never gave up her faith in Jesus, in the communist Amen. Regime. And Amen. she was mocked. She was spat at. She was, and she didn't care. She didn't care. She would not give her allegiance to the state. She gave her allegiance to Jesus. And guess what? Communism is dead, but Jesus is still alive. And, Amen. So again, any dictatorship and Muhammad and some people, who was it? Was it Bertrand Russell who said that Muhammad is the greatest of all dictators? I like, that's a compliment, you know? That's no compliment, guys. Trust me, to be a dictator is not a compliment. But interestingly, that because a lot of those conversions, and today same thing, a lot of the conversions are not real. They're fake because people are scared. And guess what? Rabbi Zachariah said this, brother. Give Muslim countries the freedom to choose if they want to be Muslims or not, without any persecution, without any, just freedom like in the US or in Europe to convert to Islam. Give them a freedom and you go from 1.7, 1.8 billion, whatever the number is, you probably cut that in half easily, if not by two-thirds. Because if people truly have the freedom and even more than the freedom, if they had the freedom of expression, and we had, they had this, what you and I are doing, if we had that on open air on Saudi TV at 8 p.m. prime time, and we bought the time on TV, guess how many more people would be converting? So
that's right. And you know, it's amazing, really. I'm going to put our clown friend again. He has an interesting comment that will go along with what we are saying.
Be careful when you say clown, because I like clowns. So I'm
okay. Well, he's a nice version of the clowns, you know. He's just a nicer one. So he's saying that, you know, according to the Quran, the man-made book, of course, it says that the followers of Jesus are Muslims. You know, here's what's so interesting, by the way, along the line of what you just mentioned, brother. The Quran, actually, in chapter 3, in the story, the narrative of Christ, you know, it says something to the extent that the Allah of the Quran made the followers of Jesus superior, basically, until the day of resurrection. And it was mentioned in another part of the Quran as well. Contrast this now with right after the death of Muhammad, what happened? The war of the apostates. Scores of people left, because they discovered that, man, that was a dictator. He's dead. We're leaving. But of course, they went after them and they killed them. That's the big difference between the followers of Jesus who suffered and continue to suffer till this day, and Christianity lasted for 2,000 years, versus the followers of Muhammad who, the minute he kicked the bucket, they left Islam immediately. So just wanted to bring this out. And
can you put that question back? Because actually,
I actually
like that question. Actually, I don't know Ibrahim, but I like his questions. honest to God. Usually the questions I get are so silly, you know, I'm not going to go through some of them, but they're so silly in debates. They're just made up questions. But actually, that's a good question. Can you put it back on there?
Yeah, we're going to try to find it.
It's okay. I got it. I know it. He asked if the true enemies of Jesus are the Pharisees, the leaders of the time. Well, actually, that's a very good question. Because the reason it's a good question is that no and yes. If they were truly the Jewish leaders of the time, then they would have pointed to Jesus and they would have recognized him. But guess what? At the time, they were the enemies. Yes, they were enemies of Jesus. And why? Because they had gained so much power that they were more interested, their hearts. See, in Christianity, it's not about what you say, what you do. It's not about, Jesus warns about going and praying and showing you holiness in front of righteousness in front of people and doing things to make yourself look good. It's not about that. It's about the heart. Paul talks about that, circumcision of the heart. And we'll talk about Paul and Abraham. I want you to hear about Paul, who was a Pharisee, who was a Jewish leader, who was under the law. And guess what? Under the law, he says it, and I'll read it to you. He was saying he was perfect, faultless. I was faultless under the law. And yet, he will admit that until he knew Christ, he was so far away from God that he didn't, you know, it's not even funny. And he was the worst of all sinners. Because what happened is that, here's what happens. Is that those leaders of the time, they were so full of themselves, and they gained so much knowledge, and they gained pride and control over people's minds. Does that sound familiar? By the way, Abraham, it sounds familiar for every religion, every, whether they're false or true, whether it's Islam, and some imams, leaders, whether it's Christianity, some pastors, or priests, or popes. Guess what? The same is true of anybody. And that's why Jesus is Lord, because he knows that and he revealed that. And he said, do not follow leaders, because leaders, I mean, unless they're true leaders, but don't follow leaders who are just because they are leaders, because they will try to control you. And that's what they were doing. The Pharisees, the leaders of the time, they were there, and they were there to control people. They were there to steal their money. They were there. You remember when Abraham, when Jesus overturned the tables? Because he was disgusted what they were doing with God's house, with his father's house. They were selling. It's like selling, like the Catholic Church, selling indulgences. And saying, you know, if you go and die in basically jihad in the Crusades, you will have eternal life. That's contradictory to Jesus' message. And it's more in line with Islam. So yes, were they enemies of the time of Jesus? Absolutely, they were enemies. Not because they were Jewish leaders, but because they were fake Jewish leaders. They were they basically usurped their power for their own benefits, and they thought they were above the law. And I will point you, Abraham, to read the story, the parable of the Good Samaritan. Read it, please, because in there Jesus uses the example of those Pharisees who were so righteous by the law, that they would not help someone in need on the side of the road. Those were enemies of God, and they still are enemies of God, and will always be enemies of God. And that is true of any religion, whether it's a false religion or true religion. They are false enemies of God, and they're using their knowledge, and they're using their controlling the power to control the minds of people. We should only be controlled by Jesus Christ and by true leaders. If they're true leaders, then we should check it with God's word, okay? And we should test the spirit. If it's not in line with God's word, which is the New Testament teachings of Jesus, then they are false teachers and false leaders. Just because they have a, in English we say, you don't judge a book by its cover. In French, we say you don't judge a monk by his habit, by his dress. Just because he has a monk dress doesn't mean he's a monk, okay? It could be on paper, but as far as Jesus is concerned, is nothing. He's very far from God. And remember one more thing, Jesus said, when he comes back, there will be a lot of people he will look at, and they will say, I did this for you, I did that for you, and he will say, I never knew you, depart from me. So Abraham, I'm sorry for this long-winded answer, but it is a good question. And if they were true leaders, they would have pointed to Jesus, because they would have recognized him as being the Lord and Savior. But they were so caught up in power over people, and they were so in love with money. Look how Jesus, he asks them questions, right? And they can't answer his questions. He puts them in the corner, and then the Bible tells us, as they could not answer because he was too smart for them, he was God in flesh, they plotted to kill him. They plotted because they wanted to get rid of him, and that's what they did. They got rid of him, and guess what his crime was? Blasphemy. So a Muslim friend of mine said, Alex, if blasphemy is punishable by death in the Old Testament, and Jesus was blaspheming, then they did the right thing by killing him, right? Seems to be make sense. That's another good question. I think it's a fair question. But actually, it was put in there for you and me, because if we blaspheme God, we should be, according to Old Testament, you know, law, we should be put to death, or very, very, very least in the New Testament. Now, if we blaspheme God, we're in danger of going to hell. But Jesus could blaspheme, because guess what? He was God. So he did not blaspheme in that sense, because he truly was God in flesh. So he had the right to claim to be God, because he was.
And what I want to ask, brother, by the way, his question is intentional here. What he's telling you is that Jesus came to the Jews only. The evidence for that is that only the Jewish leaders are the one who condemned him to death. But what's so amazing to me is our dear friend here picks and chooses. You know, like if you look at Matthew 16, for instance, or Matthew 17, Jesus was speaking in a generic fashion. And yes, he did mention that the scribes and the high priest are going to be condemning him. But here was so interesting. I'm going to read verbatim from Matthew 20, starting from 17. Jesus, for the third time now here, is predicting his basically death and resurrection. This is what he says, Matthew 20, verse 17. As Jesus was about to go up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside by themselves. And on the way, he said to them, behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered to the chief priest and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles. Yeah. To whom? Repeat after me, please. Abdul Hamid, repeat after me. To the Gentiles. So even, by the way, brother, Alex, when you look at the story, the Quran has one lonely verse in the Quran, chapter 4, verse 157, that says that Jesus wasn't crucified. But what's so funny is the theory behind who was actually made to look like Jesus to be put on the cross talks about Gentiles. Roman soldiers are the one who went after Jesus to crucify him, taken straight out of the gospel accounts.
And it's interesting, two things. Number one, it's interesting, your last point, that if it was someone else who was crucified, then then it would be in line with the nature of the God of Islam, which is to be deceitful, because that's what he did. If you put someone else and all of his disciples, including your own mother, does not even recognize you, then God has done a wonderful job of deceiving everyone. So, but that's not the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible wouldn't deceive disciples, and the Quran says that the disciples would actually be successful to the end, right? And so why would they be deceived by God? Doesn't make any sense. It was Jesus of history who died on the cross, and we know that to be a fact. And even the person I've been debating for years, the Muslim scholar in Europe, who's a rising star in the Muslim world, French-speaking Muslim world, he admitted last year, he admitted that Jesus did in fact crucified, and it's a historical fact. That's what he said, it's a historical fact, and he got death threats for saying that. But to go back to your point, let's see what was the point, because it was important to me. I don't remember now, that's too bad. It was an important point about what he would discuss.
We were talking about the fact that somebody else died in his place. That was the last
thing.
Yeah,
but before that, we were talking about being turned over. You remember that he was sent to be judged. And what did Pilate say? I find nothing wrong with this person. Even the thief on the cross turned to
and
Jesus.
And he washed his hand.
Yes, he washed his hand. Right. I want nothing to do with him. He's yours. And then what did the Jewish leader say at the time? And this is very important. You'll never hear this because it's so politically incorrect, but it is very true. And my Jewish friends need to hear that because it's very, very powerful. I can curse my family. I can curse, and there can be, the Old Testament talks about your family being cursed for up to seven generations. What happens is that, you know, the Jewish leaders of the time, and shame on them for saying that, they said, fine, let his blood be on our hands and our children's hands. That is terrible. What they did, they cursed their own people, the people, their own followers, for generations to come, by saying that that his blood would be on their hands. And that is so sad, because he died for our sins, and that we should not be cursing our children with the death of Jesus. So anyway, that's a side point.
I'm going to have a comment in front of you, brother. Feel free to answer it if you like or respond to it, from another friend. His name is Saif. Saif, thank you, by the way. Saeed, I'm sorry for sharing your comment. You pop up here periodically. So he's basically saying, and then I'm going to go back to another one here. I'm sorry. Let's watch this one. He's complaining that God basically was a criminal by sending his son to die on the cross. I mean, we've heard this so many times, of course. And that God did not do anything to his son when he was on the cross, when he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? So what would you like to say, brother?
I would say, you know, I was in my first debate with a Muslim in Paris, in France, I explained that that God is all love, and I will get into love later, but that God is all love, that he loves us, and he loves us so much that he wants to save us, okay? That's one attribute of God. The other attribute of God is that he's perfect justice, and he has to judge us for our sins. And Syed, listen to me. You would have to admit, let me just go through some of the commandments in the Bible. For example, have you ever stolen anything or taken something that's not yours? I have, therefore I'm a thief. I'm sorry, you don't have to steal a million times to be a thief. You steal once and you're a thief. The Bible in James, it says that, you know, if you break one law, you've broken all of them. So we're all on the same playing field. I'm no better than you, Syed, and you're no better than me. We're both sinners. And so you and I are thieves. Have we ever committed adultery? I've never committed adultery. Wait. Jesus said, if you look at a woman with lust in your eyes, you have committed adultery. Guilty. I'm an adulterer, and so are you. I'm sure you have looked at women with lust in your eyes. Have you ever murdered anyone? No, probably not, and I haven't. Well, wait a second. Jesus said, if you hate anybody, any of your brothers, you have hatred in your heart, you have committed adultery. What Jesus did is he took the law and took it to a whole new level, because people who are under the law, They thought they were good people like Paul because he was faultless. He was obeying all the laws, and yet he was so far from God. Does that sound familiar? A lot of my Muslim friends are the same way. They're so obedient, but yet they're so far from God. And here's the thing, is that so we are adulterers, murderers, we're thieves, and I can keep on going, right? So under God's law, you, Sayyid, or me and Al are guilty, and we deserve hell. So here's God who has to send us to hell, but loves us so much, he wants to save us. The only way, since I cannot save myself, Al Fadi cannot save himself, you, Sayyid, cannot save yourself, the only way those two can intersect is on the cross. And where Jesus takes, where there's the justice, which is on the cross, it's the, our sin is being punished for on the cross. So there is a payment for that. And by the way, this is not nothing new. The Old Testament talks about it, where it says life is in the blood. And there were sacrifices in the Old Testament for the forgiveness of sins. They were temporary until the coming of Messiah, who was a perfect lamb, who was a perfect sacrifice. So the only intersection between perfect love of God and perfect justice, where he has to judge us and send us to hell, is the cross, where he sends his son. And no, it's not a criminal activity. It is an activity of grace. It's an act of grace, of love, because God so loved the world, John 3:16, that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And brother, Sayyid, I don't know you. I don't know your heart. But if you want to make your heart right with God, this is the only way. The only way. The Bible says, the Old Testament, that our good deeds are like dirty, filthy rags to God. If we come to God and say, look what I did, he will look at them as, you know, and say it. I don't know if you're married, if you're dating, but you don't, your girlfriend or wife did not score brownie points for you to marry her. You love her just the way she is. I hope you do. But we don't deal with this in love. I'm not friends with Al because he's sending me money every day. Feel free to do it. But it, again, I love him because he's my friend. I accept him just the way he is. And it's the same with everyone else. God is, accepts you the way you are. He loves you, but he has to judge you. And so it's either you being judged for your own actions, for your own deeds, and therefore you will get hell, or God, you accept God's mercy and grace on the cross and his shedding of the blood. Remember the Old Testament, the Israelites had to put blood of the animal above the doorposts, because when God would come, if he saw blood on the doorpost, he would pass over, that's what we call it, Passover, their sins and not judge them. He is our perfect Passover lamb, Jesus. He died for sin and he shed his blood so that you and I and everyone else can be eternal life. And I pray that you do, Sayyid. I hope that you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, because there's nothing like it. You will have incredible peace, incredible relationship with your Creator, and you will have the assurance that he loves you and that you have eternal life and that you don't have to do one thing. And guess what? You will do more things as a Christian than you do as a Muslim, because you will be free to do it and you have the Holy Spirit to help you do it. And I pray that you do, in Jesus' name. Yeah.
And here's I just want to add a couple of points here and then read a passage real quickly. And we are approaching, sadly, our the end of our show. So that's why I'm going to have our dear brother with us every Wednesday at 6 p.m. New York time, Eastern time, basically for this purpose, because we have a lot here to discuss and he has a lot to offer to us. And his book hopefully will be out soon. And you guys, I encourage you, of course, to go ahead and get a hold of this book, because it's very simple. I've looked at the draft copy and it will be extremely powerful and practical for you. So brother, I mean, our friend here, Sayyid or Saeed, you know, he's basically upset with the fact that God basically is a criminal by putting an innocent person on a cross. Okay, so I'm going to ask you, Sayyid, who did Allah put on the cross? We know who our God put on the cross. Okay, that's his son. Who did Allah put on the cross? You tell me who's the criminal now. Okay, number two is that the saddest thing is like Allah left his son, our God, Yahweh, left his son to be tortured. Well, you know what? Jesus came to die on the cross in the first place, but no, God didn't leave him. You just go and read Psalm 22 all the way to the end and you'll see. He didn't leave him. So number two, and he's a proof that he didn't leave him. He came back to life. What is Jesus right now by the admission of the Quran? He's alive in heaven right now. What happened to that poor soul that Allah put on the cross? Do you know anything about him, Alex? Have you heard his name? Do you know what happened to that poor soul? He's dead. I mean, I don't know what happened to him. So which one is a criminal and which one is ravaging, unfortunately, person who enjoyed putting an innocent person to die for no reason other than the fact that he deceived others, like you said.
Yeah, and a couple points. I guess Saeed could say, well, but Jesus was innocent. He shouldn't be dying where Judas was not innocent. Therefore, he deserved to die. But that being said, you're right that he would have deceived people. But Saeed, I just want to ask you a question. If you go in court of law and you're guilty and the judge has to send you to prison, and someone comes along and says, judge, please, I want to pay the fine or whatever to bail out this person. I will pay for that person and just let them free. What would your reaction be? Well, that's not fair. That's not fair. Why would you want to do that? You know, you didn't commit crime. Or would you be like, wow, really? Why would you do that for me? Well, because I love you. Because I love you and I want to set you free. Just think about that, Saeed. You know, there are two reactions. Sure, you could be saying, no, you know, get out of my sight. You know, I deserve it. I'll pay for it. Sure. If you want to pay for your own sins, but I promise you, Saeed, it's not going to be pretty, because when you stand in front of God and you have the blood of Jesus, you will see all of your sins, your whole life come in front of you, and you will have to account for every single of your sins, and you will be held accountable, and you will be guilty under the law, because God's righteousness, His holiness, is perfect. And so in the Bible, the holiness of God is mentioned 500 times. Or more in the Quran, 5 times only. So Muslims don't really realize how important the holiness of God is. It is so important that you and I cannot be commingled with Him. We cannot enter His presence. We are too unholy. In the Old Testament, they would not even go in the priests would go in the holies once a year. They would have something attached to his waist with a rope, so that in case when he got in the presence of God, something happened, they would pull him out, because no one can be in the presence of God, because we're so impure, so unrighteous. There's no one good, the Bible says, in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. There's no one good, not one. And there's no one who seeks God. So if you think you love God, you don't, Saeed. You don't. No one loves God. No one seeks after God. We're all selfish. And when you do your prayers and you do all those things, you're doing it for your own self, because you are acquiring brownie points. So again, you need the freedom of Christ, because God sent His only Son to die for you. Is it just? No. But it's called grace. And one of the points next week we're going to cover is a point of grace, which is so unique to Christianity. There's no such a thing in any other religion. But remember, Saeed, if you're in a court of justice and you have to pay a fine and you're guilty and you have to go to prison and someone else comes and pays a fine for you, how will you react? Will you say, nope, it's not your debt, I will pay myself, I'll go to prison? Or will you be grateful for that person because they loved you and they showed grace towards you, even though they absolutely did not have to? And if that's a big deal here, imagine how much of a big deal it is to stay away from eternity, separate from God.
Amen. And you know, there is one question I keep asking our Muslim friends to answer for me. Why was Adam kicked out of heaven, because a Muslim believe he was in heaven, for one only sin? Just one. Mm-hmm. And if he was kicked out and then he was forgiven, as the Quran claims, why wasn't he allowed back?
Yeah, that's one of my point number one in my first debate 8 years ago in Paris. My point number one was, why, if there's no original sin and sin of Adam and Eve are not big deal, why did Allah kick out Adam and Eve out of heaven, out of paradise? So that's a good question. That's a very good question that our Muslim friends need to answer. But also, Saeed and other Muslim friends, you have to answer the question, that if you don't believe in original sin and you don't believe we're imputed Adam and Eve's human nature and sinful nature, you need to deny all of the biblical teachings, right? You have to deny all of it. So basically, you're denying, you're saying only the Quran is correct, and you have to reinterpret, you have to deny a lot of teachings, fundamental teachings in the Old Testament and New Testament, and that's more problematic for you than it is for us, because we Christians don't have to reinterpret the Old Testament. It is in line with the New Testament.
So, may I make a couple of comments? Sayyid is saying that Adam was created of earth, therefore he was destined to go back to earth. If you can show me a single verse in a creation narratives plural of Adam, because you know there is so many scenarios of how Adam was created, if you can show me anything that says this, I'll grant you this point. And Sayyid, I just read a comment that you are going to debate Sam Shamoun. You know what Alex says about, you know, you need Jesus? You're going to need Jesus big time if you're debating Sam Shamoun. I mean, let us know. We'll be praying for you. That's for sure.
Yeah. Go ahead, Alex. I like to tell people, and I don't know if Sam is watching, but I hate to give him too much credit because we like to give each other a hard time with Sam. But I told Sam is so good that I wouldn't debate him even if I took the wrong side. I wouldn't even debate Sam. He would destroy me even if I took the wrong side. But we debated this Muslim Frenchman last year in France, or 2 years ago. Maybe 2 years ago, and Sam annihilated him with good arguments. And the for the last hour of the debate, the Muslim was so scared to open his mouth. So and after that, his ministry went downhill. So we pray for him, of course, because we're not there to humiliate people. That's not our nature, or our end goal is not to humiliate anybody or to destroy the arguments per se, but rather we really want to see people like Sayyid have eternal life and to have a personal relationship with God, because Adam and Eve had that personal relationship with God in the Garden of Eden, and so Jesus came to restore a personal relationship with our living Father. And so I pray that Sayyid, you come into that relationship with God, because he loves you, but he is just, and he must judge all of our sins. So either you stand on your own and you'll be guilty, or you stand with the greatest advocate ever in the history of humanity, and that is Jesus Christ, the perfect being who died for your sins, who loves you so much that he willingly and willfully, because again, a criminal, you know what would be criminal? What would be criminal, Al, and then we'll end it with this. What would be criminal is if a father told the son, I'm sending you to die, and the son said, no, I'm not going. I don't care whether you like it or not. You're going, and you're going to die. Well, first of all, that could not be possible, because the father and the son are one, and so they could not be contradictory. But if that were the case, then yes, it would be criminal to send him against his will. But guess what? Jesus did it by his own will. He was happy to do it, because although he was in his human flesh, he was anxious and scared and cried, because who wants to go to die, you know, especially when you're innocent, you know, in the flesh. But he did it willingly. He did it willingly because he loves us, and he died on the cross for us. So it's nothing criminal. What's criminal is if a father had sent the son against the son's will.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, brother. And as we mentioned, next Wednesday, we have our next interview with our dear brother. We'll continue along the arguments that he is raising in his book, and we'll look at comments. I enjoyed it today. We interacted with a number of you. Thank you. I want to thank Sayyid for commenting. Thank you to all of you, of course. And I want to thank also Abdulhamid. Ibrahim Abdulhamid for interacting with us. We encourage you, of course, to come back again next week. I want to remind everybody also that on Friday, Lord willing, I will have Sister Hatoon with us. And on Saturday, I will be on Fonder Films with Dr. J. And then Sunday, 50-50 right now, be praying. We have also another special edition with another powerful testimony. So we will keep you posted. Brother, thank you so much for being with us. Any final thoughts, any final words you want to share with anyone?
I just pray for everyone right now, because difficult times for a lot of people. who are being quarantined and confined in their places. And I just pray that through times like this, not only will people who don't know Jesus come to know to the knowledge of him, but I pray that Christians will realize what it's all about, because we've been a little complacent. The church has been a little complacent, especially in the West. And by the way, that's another point that that I will grant Muslims when they say, when they see the church being so lazy. I'll grant it to them that we are, because we've become so blessed in the West that we forget sometimes where the blessings come from. So I pray, my prayer is that the church will come together and will wake up for, you know, and realize what it's all about.
Amen, brother. Thank you so much. Appreciate you as always. And I'm looking forward to our next episode next Wednesday at 6 p.m. Eastern time or New York time. Until then, everyone, have a blessed day. Take care.
Thank you. God bless. Thank you.